Welcome, everybody, and I'm very happy to welcome Marc Fleurbaey, professor of economics and humanities, actually, at Princeton, and also the chair of welfare economics and social justice at Collège d'études mondiales and at some other places. And most importantly, you are the head of the International Panel of Social Progress, this fantastic initiative to bring together, I think, close to 300 researchers in different areas to kind of write a state-of-the-art report with 22 chapters on what is going on, how can we get social progress. And that's what you're going to talk about today. And I'm very happy because the Institute is also involved in supporting six of this chapter with funding from Riksbankens Jubileumsfond. So we've had six of this chapter here in a kind of working phase during the spring. And now we hope to hear a little bit more about the results. So welcome, very welcome. The floor is yours.
So thank you, Gustav, for the kind introduction. I'm not the head of the panel, but I'm working in it as a kind of janitor, trying to put the broom in the corners. And so I'm very pleased to have the occasion to test first impressions from what we have in the report with you. And I'm very happy to receive your feedback and your reactions to this, because I will do my presentation in two stages. I will first start by explaining a little bit what this panel is about and how it was organized and so on. And then I will give some impressions that you get when you browse the first draft of the report. So we now have a first draft that is online, and I will explain where, so you can look at it and comment and so on. It's a bit hard for me to be very precise because it's very recent, so I haven't absorbed everything very thoroughly. So take what I will present about the report more as my impressions, my take from it, rather than a collective work of synthesis on the results. We have not yet done that. We will do it, of course, and we will produce synthesis in various forms, but this is more a personal presentation of what I get so far from the report. Feel free to interrupt me if you have any questions or clarification issues along the way. Okay. So when people ask me what the report is about, so of course it's about social progress, but what kind of issues about social progress? So the easy answer is everything, and you have here the list of chapters which cover many topics. So sorry, this is a bit small, but don't worry, the next slides will be less small. So we have three big parts, one about socioeconomic issues, one about political issues, and one more about values, norms, cultures, and issues which are not just fitting in one of these two places. We also have very interesting parts in the beginning and at the end. So the end is not yet written, because that requires reading the previous chapters, but we have very nice introductions about the social trends, the history of society, and about the definition of social progress. So perhaps I should say a word about social progress. Social progress is an expression that was chosen during a long meeting with the Scientific Council, where people were discussing about the name of the panel, of course, but whether social progress or social change or social transformation was a good name. And progress was chosen because it is not an academic term. It is a term that is actually something that the academics don't use very much and try to be cautious about. But it is used a lot in the public debate. And so given the role of this panel, which is to talk to society, to convey idea to social actors, we thought it was nice to rely on vocabulary, on terms that people do use in the public debate. So tell me, let me tell you a bit about the context of the creation of this panel. We had many conversations with various people, including Gustav at some point, and people at the IPCC as well, the panel on climate change, about the fact that we are in an interesting period where policymakers perhaps tend to focus a little bit too much on technical solutions and not enough on social issues of institutions. And there is at the same time a lack of vision due to the fact that some utopias that people believed in when I was a small kid, for instance, have now died, and it's probably a good thing that they have died, but there is a void, and people are looking for some long-term vision, and when they don't have any long-term vision, they are a bit at a loss. So we are in a very interesting period, because this is an opportunity to start thinking anew. Can we build not perhaps as simplistic and dangerous utopias as we had before, but visions that are more realistic, more complex, but also useful to have a view of what can happen in the long term. And what can help us to do that is that there has been many things happening in the social sciences since the last war in Europe, and so all this investment that has been done could be used to make this sort of effort, with the difficulty that it's hard to imagine that anyone of us individually could be able to do it, because there is a lot of specialization, so we know a lot about a small field of a sub-discipline and so on. It's very hard to really grasp the whole progress made by social sciences, and so that's why we thought we needed a collective brain to do this kind of exercise. And this is, we are not sure we will make a big contribution, that's a test. And the question, the big question at the end for academic people is, can we be useful, right? Can social sciences really make an impact? That's something to be seen. And in a way, this is an experiment. Of course, there are many other ways, many other initiatives that try to do that, but this is one way. So who is involved there? So you have a few institutions, so the Foundation Maison des Sciences de l'Homme, Gustave has been involved there a lot, and the Princeton University have been the initiators, essentially. We have many other academic institutions, and the Institute is one of them as a sort of representative of the panel in Sweden, and we have some foundations who have been helping. So as Gustav said, we have about 300 people involved with various committees. So Amartya Sen is chairing the advisory committee. We have a scientific council chaired by Nancy Fraser, Ravi Kambor, and Elga Novotny, so different disciplines. And we have about 45 people in the scientific council. And we have a steering committee with Olivier Boin, who is a director at FMSH, and myself. I've put our two names, but that doesn't mean that we are leading the steering committee. It's an horizontal thing, so we are doing a lot of work, but that doesn't mean that we have more power than the others in the committee. Okay, so we should be modest. There are many other things that exist, and many other things that go in the same direction to some extent. So if we talk about the IPCC, for instance, the IPCC is doing a great job in the last round, thanks to the leadership of a few figures in the group. Philosophers have been hired, and they have a lot of emphasis has been placed, including by the leadership of IPCC, on ethical issues. So that was a good contribution. The World Social Science Report this year is about inequalities, and we have a lot of overlap of authors between the two reports. The UNRIS, the UN Research Institute for Social Development, has a flagship report that is now being finalized, where they highlight the social economy, so the social sector or solidarity sector that is, as they claim, a promising part of social developments. The World Happiness Report is now a kind of institution that is coming up regularly, pushing the agenda of happiness. There have been other commissions. Let me mention the OECD Stiglitz Group, which is a follow-up to the Stiglitz and F2C Commission, which is, again, with an overlap between the members of the two groups. They focus on the measurement. And in the IPSP, we don't focus so much on measurement. We focus more on policy issues, institutional change. So what can be done really, not just the measure. But the measure is indeed important, and it's very good that we have coordination with them. There are a few other things. So for instance, we are also connected to the Social Progress Imperative. Michael Porter is the key leader of this initiative, which is about pushing various dimensions of social progress, which are not just economic development, but other non-market aspects. So the objectives, I've already alluded to that. We want to touch two kinds of audiences. We are interested in our colleagues, so we would like to do a bit like what the IPCC has been doing for climate studies, the IPCC has encouraged research in not just in climate science, but also in economics and other social sciences about climate policy. And so it would be nice if this group was encouraging scholars more broadly to look at long-term social perspective, right? So that's and structural issues. So that's one of the goals. The IPCC has an institutional setting to do that because you have rounds, and between two rounds of the IPCC report, people write papers that they hope will be published in the next report. Right. So we are not yet there. We are not sure we'll have a continuing institution. We hope there will be something like that. So if that happens, we can hope to have this sort of encouragement toward research. But our important audience also is just people who can be change makers, as the expression seems to be nowadays. And that includes not just governments, policymakers, but also other civil society organizations, NGOs, and ordinary citizens, and all that, think tanks. That's the difference with the IPCC. The IPCC is really talking to mostly to governments and is mandated by governments. We want to make recommendations to a broader set of players. We are not mandated, as I said, by governments, and so that's an advantage in the sense that we are independent. We can really set our own agenda, and we really put a high value on having different disciplines working together and focusing. So it's not the goal is not to join disciplines just for the sake of joining disciplines. The goal is to let different disciplines look at the same topic with their own angle and see how these different angles can fit together. And we have this, I will say a bit more about stakeholders' feedback in a moment, because we want to produce this big report, which will be a three-volume thing. We would like to keep online material, so we will have comments, for instance, and we will keep that on the website. And we will produce several syntheses, so especially a small book for a wider audience, and we are also working on having video products. So the goal is really to reach a wide audience. So the kind of skepticism that we meet when we present this kind of thing is, oh yeah, but a report, when it's collective writing, people seek a consensus, you get a bland minimum denominator kind of conclusion. Of course we have to see what we get, but we have the impression that there is a demand for this kind of work. People are anxious about the future, and people are not happy about the trends that they are observing, like some people being left behind and so on, and the 1% story. So we feel there is a demand for a study of possibilities of social progress, and we want really to focus on real issues, not just on academic hair splitting, right? So it's not a presentation of academic schools, it's a discussion of real issues, and see if we can come up with interesting stuff. And we want to be open about disagreements. And so that's something that is important. We, of course, we'll have in the chapters, we have people from different disciplines, and Gustav is very aware of the difficulties of making people from different disciplines work together. And so the goal, their mandate is to, their mission is not to agree, but is to agree about what they disagree about. Right? So that's the idea. So be objective about the disagreement and be act as a filter. So eliminate the things that have become obsolete and keep the things that remain relevant and that should be considered as still on the table. One word about being prescriptive. So we won't be shy in terms of recommendations, but we'll try to be clear about the underlying values, right? So the way we say it is the IPCC has a sort of motto or mantra, which is we should be policy relevant but not prescriptive, not policy prescriptive. So that's very tough, very hard to achieve. We want to be prescriptive, but we want to be in the IPSP, but we want to be conditionally prescriptive, which means that recommendations depend on an objective or a value or a principle that people may endorse or may not endorse, right? That's the idea. Okay, so yeah, I already explained about how to handle disagreements, and so let me skip that. And we are, in terms of organization, the chapters are independent teams, and so an author in this group doesn't sign the whole report, sign just the chapter, but the chapter is co-signed by all authors. So the goal is to have chapters that are not a succession of sections written by different people, but something that is co-signed by everyone. Okay, it's almost there. Not all chapters have been able to really take this formula, but we are almost there. There is a question of another criticism we hear very often is that this will be just another report on the shelves. Can we have any influence on real processes? Again, the comparison with the IPCC is interesting. So the IPCC is mandated by governments, so governments have the official obligation to pay attention, and there is a heavy process of discussion between the experts and the governments. We don't have anything like that, so we have to rely on our own initiative. And so we need to have many partners in terms of dissemination, and we need to rely on our own networks. And to find interest in various organizations. So we are working on that, and so far the things seem to be looking good, but it's very important to involve people. And we want to involve them in the conception of the report, because we now have, let me skip the selection of the authors, we now have a phase of involvement of the stakeholders that I'll describe in a moment. Let me briefly describe the authors we have in terms of a discipline mix. So that we have three big things here: economists, sociologists, and political scientists. Philosophy is not badly represented, right, for a social science panel. Law is also quite important. Gender balance is not bad, could be better. Okay, but it's better than tenured positions in the field, but it's worse than PhDs in the field. So the future will be better if we continue like that. If you want to have an image of the brain drain, that's where our authors were started their studies, and that's where they work now. And so this is Europe, and this is the US, North America. So you see something is happening between where people start and where they end up working. And so we wanted to be global and to invite people from the global south. It was hard, let me be frank. We asked for many names, suggestions, and all that. We got many names of people who were in this category. They started there, but they are now working in the north. Right. So that's the difficulty. Let me say a word about the process before I go to the content. So we have started working about a year ago. Over the spring we had chapter workshops. Six have taken place here at the Institute, so thanks so much to the Institute for helping us a lot. And now the first draft is online for almost all the chapters, and we are inviting comments. So this invitation goes to everyone, especially to people like you. So please, if you have some time to waste during lunchtime or whatever, please go to the thing. You can read the report and you can comment. The platform is rather user-friendly. And there are other things that you can invite people to come to. We have opinion surveys and discussion forums. But really, for people like you, we would very much welcome comments. And we organize meetings with various organizations. So we had a meeting in Geneva with international organizations, with meeting at the OECD. We went to the World Social Forum. We have a connection with the World Economic Forum. So you see, we connect to as widely as possible. And we have branches in countries. So the Institute is the IPSP representative in Sweden and is activating its own network. But we have 36 countries now with a branch. And so then after that, we'll of course take stock of the comments. We have a second meeting of the authors, we'll prepare the final version, and then we have to work on dissemination. Okay, so enough for the process and where this comes from. Should I stop here if there is any question about that before I go to the content? Okay, good. So this is again the list of chapters, and let me say what I draw from it while reading the various things and discussing with authors and all that. So I think my impression is that there will be more to the whole than to the addition of the parts. I'm quite excited about it, but I'm not yet sure what I'm going to say is interesting. But I think with some work we can do something that is promising. So, and that's where I very much welcome your reactions here. So the first thing that is important is a sort of Polanyi kind of analysis, where the idea is the trends that we've been through are essentially that the market is a wild beast that, if you let it on its own, is creating too much risk for society and for individuals. Individuals need to have insurance that is not provided well enough by the market. And so the state needs to have a role to tame this beast and to make things livable for people, to ensure livelihoods. And so what has happened in the last decades and centuries is that there have been big crises, and the state has taken a greater place, and that was after the 1929 crisis, the creation of the welfare state, and especially after the war, but even before the war, especially in the US. And so this greater place of the state was a way to make things livable, keeping the market economy, but making it livable thanks to insurance mechanisms around it. So that's the idea of embedding the market in social institutions that make it serve society. And what happened starting in the 70s, 80s was globalization and deregulation that has somehow let the market genie go out of the social bottle again. And so we have to invent some form, and creating a lot of new risk and new uncertainty for people's livelihoods. And therefore, we need to invent a new formula that re-embeds the market into social institutions. But when you say that, you don't say much. So that's nice to understand the trends. It doesn't give you a clue about what kind of institutions, social institutions, could do the trick of taming the market again. And so I like very much this way of presenting the trends. I don't think it helps us understanding what we should do, right? So that's, but at least it's a good picture. Then we have special challenges. So one thing, Polanyi also talks about that. One issue is labor and the livelihood of workers and households, but the other thing is nature. And so we have a big challenge now. The environmental degradation is becoming a serious problem. And so we need to think about sustainability and restore sustainability, but at the same time, we still have many people who have not benefited very much from growth and globalization. Many countries still need to catch up. And so you know this Angus Deaton story about the Great Escape, right? So the rich countries, the emerging economies, are now getting out of subsistence state and poverty, but we have this great catch-up movement that is yet to be done for many people and countries. And so we need to reduce inequalities and at the same time restore sustainability. These two things are very hard to do together, because if everybody were to adopt the lifestyle of perhaps not so much the Swedish lifestyle, but the American lifestyle for sure, that would be an explosion of the planetary boundaries right away. But still, we could imagine doing something like that with sufficiently authoritarian policies. But if we want to remain democratic and empower people and let them choose their lifestyle, then this becomes a very hard equation, right? So I would describe this as a challenge of our time. Find a way to do these three things together. If we, it's not that they are just in contradiction, somehow they are also linked, because social sustainability will not be obtained if we don't reduce inequalities. And so all that is intention, but also going together in some way, right? And if we have an authoritarian solution to this problem, that will also be socially unsustainable. So this is something that is, somehow we need to achieve all of that together, but it's very hard to do it. So the trends, the challenge for the future, and how to think about these things. So I've shown you the structure of the report, which has these three parts, which is pretty classical and convenient, with disciplines split here a little bit, so many economists around here, many political scientists here, and so on, right? So that's convenient, but that doesn't work. So what we see, thanks to the interdisciplinary that we have in the various chapters, is that this separation that you still find in many books about the economic sphere, the political sphere, and the social sphere, this is a bit obsolete. This doesn't work very well. So in all institutions, in all human activities, you have the same ingredients. And the same ingredients are issues having to do with the distribution of resources, power, information, and status. So resource is pretty obvious, and you have it not just in economics, but also in political issues and so on. Status is perhaps obvious for some disciplines, a bit less obvious for economists, but is also something that is quite classical. Power is touchy. Power is touchy. Power is obviously important in political processes, but recognizing politics in places where it's usually ignored is very important. And so you have in many institutions, including economic institutions, you have issues of power. So that's something that is interesting to develop. Information, I'm less sure about how to describe that. It pops up in some chapters, not in many places. So I have the impression it's something that's emerging. There is one form of it which is almost everywhere, that's education. But there is another form, which is access to information about what's going on, access to relevant information to be able to autonomously find your livelihood and all that. And what is developed in the chapter on media communications, access to production of information. So the fact that people want to be producers at a certain stage, want to be part of the conversation, right? So there is this new role of information that is coming up. Okay, if you are an economist, when you look at that, you say, oh, that looks very much like mechanism design. There is a theory of economics that uses game theory to analyze the design of institution, and you find these ingredients, including information, not so much status, but you find resources, power, and information very much there. So I'm not just inspired by that, but looking at the chapters, I find that indeed there is something that connects to this kind of approach there. Something that is not our main focus, because we are not so much on measurement, but is good to mention, is that we need much better data. And you know there has been a very popular effort made on the analysis of the distribution of resources, income and wealth, with the Atkinson-Piketty group and these people. But not much is done about power, and the distribution of power in the various institutions is something that is not well known. A lot more needs to be done. So Gustav and I have been working on the measurement, the definition of the measure of power, even just the concept of the concept that we should try to measure. The concept itself is still very much a contested notion. So a lot more needs to be done on measurement of some of these dimensions. Okay, so that's these are the conceptual tools. Of course, it remains a bit vague. I hope you are not too disappointed, but. Now, let me look at the key policy issues. So the key drivers of changes in the last decades have been globalization and technical change. So there seems to be an agreement in the various chapters about that. And these drivers are producing good things, but also bad things for some people. And now it's official, by the way, the G20 in China a couple of weeks ago officially acknowledged that we needed to take care of the people who don't benefit from globalization, and they wanted to make efforts in that direction. So that's the key question is how to deal with these, the fact that these changes are not always for the good of everyone. So you have different options. One obvious option that is quite popular nowadays in the US, that's Donald Trump, put a brake on globalization. Innovation could also sometimes be considered to be a danger, but it's a different kind of voice that airs this idea. So that's something that is also popular in France, on some parts of the left and so on. So you have now the brakes put on trade negotiations and so on are very much part of that. A better option, I mean, the report seems to be advocating that this is not the best option because this is inefficient in a way. So you are essentially clipping your branches, tools that are more communication, more trade and so on that potentially useful are just not used if you do that. So it's better to keep things open and use all possible technologies and possible communications, but try to find ways to compensate the losers, right? So that's the challenge. The question is, even if we agree that that's preferable, what are the means to do that? And that's, to be discussed in quite some detail. So several chapters discuss that in various ways, especially the chapter on labor. But there is another thing that appears that is interesting, is a bit more original, which is that you can also try to somehow control the direction that globalization, or the form that globalization and technical change take. And then, by doing that, make sure that you have less losers than you would have spontaneously, right? And so regarding globalization, for instance, you can focus on transfers of information so that you really take care of putting the developing, the emerging economies on a good stage in terms of being able to compete and to receive technologies and so on. And you can also, something that appears a lot in the various chapters is that technical innovation is a very endogenous process, and you can in various ways try to orient it. And the way the institutions are set up nowadays make it naturally labor unfriendly, and so the challenge is to try to make technical innovation more labor friendly. Okay, now a bit back to the Polanyian story. We need to tame the markets, finance and corporations. And so what does that mean? The markets are, so if you expect this bunch of social scientists to say that the market is awful, that will not happen. And I don't know whether that's an event or not, but it's endorsing the market. So the market economy is certainly something that will stay with us if we believe the report. And the markets are very good. They have key efficiency properties for the allocation of resources, and they have also good normative properties in terms of freedom. So markets are important, but markets have flows, and it's important to let people know. And this is something, for instance, that this is an aside, but business schools don't teach that very well. The market failures are something that people in business school don't learn. People in economic departments do learn that a bit more. And so there is a need to make the public more aware of the failures of the market. So markets are not good about inequalities. That's so they can just preserve inequalities from endowment to final allocation, or they can worsen inequalities with the random events that happen. Some people get trapped in low states or in poverty states. So inequalities are not handled very well by the market. Concentration is something that is, of course, a problem. So markets tend to produce market power by concentration, and so you need to tame that and to keep competition. Externalities, that's very well known, are not taken care of by the market spontaneously. So you need some ways of making the externalities being internalized by the agents. Information is not handled well in two ways. You have the situations in which people don't have full information about what they are trading. So that's what is called asymmetric information by the economists. And that is something that makes the markets work badly. And the general impact of that is generally to make markets too small, because people don't trust the other party enough, right? And so the markets don't develop as much as they could. That's one way in which the market don't perform well for information. The other way is expectations. The markets don't provide information. They provide information about demand and supply, scarcity through the prices, but they don't help people forming their expectations about the future very well. And so you have this issue of bubbles and self-fulfilling prophecies and all that. So that's another way in which information is not handled very well by markets. And a last thing that is not so popular in economics, but is actually mentioned in the Jean Tirole, the last French Nobel Prize in economics, last book, is motivation. So the markets favor a certain kind of motivation for doing things, extrinsic motivation, and sometimes it's better to encourage another kind of motivation, intrinsic motivation for the activity that you have. So you have things like Wikipedia, for instance, that work on intrinsic motivation, and that may be something that we should encourage and that the markets are not really able to do by themselves. Okay, so that's something that is in a way quite basic, but so if every citizen knew that, that we perhaps we would have done, especially business leaders, we would have done a good service to society. The other thing is the corporation. So there is a debate about robotization and whether labor will disappear. So some people say, yeah, labor is an old story now. People should center their life on something else. We should give income to people independently of labor and so on, right? So there is a discourse that goes in this direction. The report is a bit conservative about that, says this kind of discourse has been held many times in the past. Automation has been feared many times, many decades ago, and we are still using a lot of labor. So labor is not likely to disappear, even with a new wave of robotization. So that's the message. Okay, let's come back in 50 years to see if that's right. And so if it doesn't disappear, then we have to look at how labor is organized. And the corporation is still a key institution that shapes people's lives and gives them status. So your social status is still very much connected to your work status. And so that's, given that it is so important, and that it plays a big role, not just in the shaping the distribution of income, but also influencing politics and so on. It's if we want to think of improving society, we have to think hard about what's going on in the corporations and around them. So what they do inside their institution, but also outside through their influence. So reforming the internal governance of corporations and reforming the interactions they have, especially with policymakers, is something that is a key aspect of the report. There is an interesting discussion to be had here about whether there is a big mistake. We are always talk about being in a market economy, but in fact we are not really in a market economy. We are more like in a corporate economy, because most of the economic activities take place outside the market within corporations. And so this is not so explicit in the report so far, but there is a big emphasis on the corporation, and it's good to really keep together the fact that it's not just issues about the economy, are not just about the market, but a lot about the non-market institutions, which are especially corporations. Another key issue which has to do with sustainability is that the report is very much pro-growth. So the report is not a degrowth report. It doesn't say we should abandon the idea of growing and so on. It still remains, again, a bit conservative on that, very much pro-growth. But it says we should really go away from growth of stuff, of material consumption, material use of resources and all that. We should continue growth, but focusing on well-being. So that's very good. But of course, there is a twist here, which is that well-being may depend on material stuff. And so if we want to enhance well-being, but people still want to travel a lot, to consume a lot, to each have their yacht and their farm and all that, that is hard to do, right? And so so that's a key issue here. What is well-being and how? So there might be a need not just to refocus growth on well-being, but also to look at the cultural shifts about what people put their interest in, right? So we might want to also decouple well-being from material stuff, and not just decouple the economy from resources. Okay, if you are not too tired, let me go on. When should I stop, Gustav?
We can go on a little bit more.
Okay. Okay, good. So yeah, I won't be very long. I don't have many slides. Actually, I have 111 slides, but I will stop in a few slides. You'll see why. So the one interesting issue that's a kind of debate in various chapters is whether the key problems we have for social progress are redistributive or are about coordination and cooperation. So whether it's a collective action or whether it's shifting things around and redistributing across people. So of course, redistribution is an important issue, inequalities and so on. And certainly wealth or resources, power and status are by themselves redistributive. Status this is positional, so that's very much. But wealth and power, power is in between, but wealth, it's classical to talk about redistribution. Information is interesting here. Information is a non-rival good, as the economists say, so you can have information and I can have it at the same time, and so the fact that you have information doesn't prevent me from using the same information. But the privileges that go with information and with education, for instance, are very rival, right? So information is something that people try to keep for themselves, even though by itself it's not rival. So the twist here is that you have to find ways to force people to share it in a way, rather than keep it for themselves and tie privileges to the possession of information. So, okay, so this is redistribution, but we also have collective action problems, which are either coordination problems or cooperation problems. And they are actually quite pervasive in the story. So some people like collective action problems because it's easier. There is a kind of promise that if you solve the collective action problem, everybody will be happy, everybody will gain, and so nobody will complain. Whereas if you talk about redistribution, then people start being afraid and say, will I lose from this story? Whereas here we can imagine win-win story. This is a bit of an exaggeration, because even collective action problems have solutions that actually typically harm some people. But nevertheless, it's interesting to think in these terms, that it's easier to win people, to win support on this in a way. So to give you an example, so if you we could imagine, for instance, using environmental pricing or taxes to generate resources that could be used to finance public goods and social services. And so that's an idea that is not explored enough and will be pushed by the report. A lot could be done if you imagine very reasonable and modest prices on environmental issues. You can generate a lot of resources. Of course, okay, so this is not a win-win for everybody, because the people who are doing the environmental degradation would suffer from the taxes and the prices. But still, for policymakers, this is a message that is very easy to get. There are new occasions to both make the market more efficient, because if you price externalities, the market becomes more efficient, and you can have resources that are hard to get now because of globalization. So that's a big issue, a big message that will be pushed. Of course, this is quite standard. Cooperation on tax and regulation is something that could help a lot if countries could get together and decide minimum standards or things like that. So that's a message that will be discussed. For instance, one chapter that says, what about having just the same unified, completely harmonized corporate tax at the world level, and impose it through sanctions on the countries that don't comply with this. Okay, that's a bit bold, but this is the kind of discussion. Another example that is not often mentioned, and perhaps not enough in the report yet, but is that in many cases you have a collective action problem which has to do with people lacking trust. And so if you find ways to increase trust by appropriate governance structures, that helps a lot, because people then invest much more in the relation. Okay, so if you don't trust someone, you won't invest in the relation with this person. And that occurs a lot in the corporations due to governance problems precisely, but it occurs in many occasions, including between citizens and governments and so on. And so when you can enhance trust, you have reduced conflictuality, greater well-being, and that can be done through good institutions. And in all kinds of institutions, from global level to the family level. Okay, so what is the balance between redistribution and collective action problem? I don't quite know, and it's interesting to try to think about how to, where should we invest the most? It might be interesting to think more about that. Okay, what happens to the state? So in the Polanyi story, we have to invent a new embedding of the market in social institutions. What is the role of the state in this new embedding? Will it be again a welfare state, a bit like what we had before? So that seems hard, because we have the globalization context, which makes it much harder for the state to do what it wants in its backyard. So as I said, the report will not suggest to put a brake on globalization. And so what can we imagine for the role of the state? So taming, I said about taming the markets and the corporations and all that. So let's be a bit more specific about how this could happen. So you have the Beveridgean or the Anglo-Saxon model, which essentially lets the market do what it wants and just has a safety net, a kind of minimum insurance for the people who fall off the cliff. This is not, in terms of social progress, this is very modest. This is not ambitious enough, right? So that's something that will not be advocated by the report very much. The Scandinavian model has strong advocates in the report. So this is my own presentation. I tend to understand it as a sort of top-down social democracy or centralized social democracy. So one key aspect of it is that you have centralized bargaining, which has key advantages in guaranteeing that you have national results in terms of wage compression, wage moderation, and so on. So that's the top-down aspect to it. You need to have representative institutions that negotiate at the top level, and then everybody is submitted to the same treatment. Another feature of this system is also universal services, which are supported by a large portion of the population. So one issue here is it exportable? And there is skepticism about that, because you need, and that's a topic that is discussed a lot in one of the chapters, you need a sort of cooperative ethos in society at large to obtain the adhesion and the discipline that occurs in the centralized bargaining process. And so that's something that, for instance, in France would be very hard to obtain. We had in the Geneva meeting, where we had discussion about these issues with international organizations and also at the OECD, that was a reaction. So a Scandinavian model, very nice, but where can you think of exporting it seriously? Another issue that I'd like to press here is that centralized, the top-down thing, top-down is perhaps not so promising in terms of social progress, because you need a lot of, it's a bit like a very, very representative system of organization, so perhaps not direct enough in terms of putting people in command of their lives, so perhaps not democratic enough. So that's an issue for the people thinking about power. The Bismarckian model, which, as you know, does some insurance via people's status on the labor market, requires a labor market where statuses are quite standard and standardized. This is something that's probably not going to be very promising in the future. The labor market is becoming more and more complex, diversity of statuses and so on. So it's probably something that we can forget if we think about the future. And there is a model that is discussed a little bit, but in various chapters, but not much, and perhaps it would be good to focus a bit more when we make the synthesis. This is compared to, it's a Scandinavian model, but where you reverse the hierarchy. I would call it the grassroots social democracy. And the idea here is that this bargaining that you have, you put it at the local level. And the state becomes the guardian of the rights of bargaining at the local level and protects the whole thing. So instead of focusing very much on redistribution, it would focus on giving people rights to protect their own livelihood at the local level. So it's sort of democratization of the economy, and that has much to do with the reform of the internal governance of the corporation. So that loses some good aspects of the centralized bargaining, so the wage compression that has some effects. So there is a long development in one chapter of the fact that wage compression is also a good way to enhance technical choices by firms, which are modernized much more homogeneous technology in Scandinavia than in the US, for instance. So it's very good to homogenize the techniques and the kind of labor that you have. So that might be a bit less good here. So there might be a role for some kind of incentivizing here. Another issue that is a kind of that's the trend of history over millennia in a way. It goes with going more autonomy to people at the local level, so people are more in charge of their own life. So people don't necessarily like it having the okay. So the best life in a way for some people at least is to be protected from above and not to have to worry too much about the decisions of your life. So I'm pushing the thing a bit, right? But to some extent, some people would enjoy very much the life of a slave having a very good master, because you don't have to care about anything. Everything is guaranteed. And so between the Scandinavian model, don't take my word in okay, but between the Scandinavian model and this model, you have less paternalism. People are more in charge of their own situation. And that is a bit scary for some people. It gives them more responsibility, more risk to some extent. So that's something that is perhaps in the sense of history, in a way, the liberation of individuals more and more, but that means that individuals are more in charge of their fate. One issue that is easy to understand and easy to remember is that all this has to do with the balance between redistribution and pre-distribution. So redistribution is when you have the market earnings and you try to make that, to redistribute that, to make to get more equality. Pre-distribution is when you tweak the institutions of the market to make the primary incomes more equal. And so that's something that is pushed especially by this model. Okay, international cooperation. Let me go quickly on that. Political issues, let me briefly mention that we are in a paradoxical era, and that's very well described in one chapter. We have democracy is a value that is now widely shared over the world. And it's amazing, if you look at the World Value Survey, democracy is supported by essentially all countries of all types. So that's something that people love, but they don't like how it works in their country, especially in the developed countries where it has worked for a long time. Now people are getting tired of it. And one reason for that is that national politicians are less effective because of globalization. So in Europe especially, people say, oh, I couldn't do that because the European Union was imposing this and so on. So you have a lot of this kind of discourse. And of course, people don't feel that politicians are effective anymore, which which makes the populist and the authoritarian politicians look more promising. So that's what we are living now. So this is a very paradoxical situation. And so what's the solution? I mean, there are long developments, but the idea is we have to re-empower people, put them back in control to some extent. So give them more occasions to participate in local institutions, including economic institutions, right? Enhance coordination. So coordination of policies can happen not just across countries, but also across various institutions like NGOs, cities. So you have networks of various local institutions that now operate at a more global level. And that's something that is promising and that is easy to do with new means of communication. Another thing that is developed a bit is that, and that comes from political scientists very much, of course, deliberation is very important. So enhance the quality of deliberation over just the political competition, the standard political competition. That's a very important aspect. And there is a debate, a kind of debate that is not very explicit in the report, but there is obviously some hesitation about whether the nation state is dead or whether it should be started again and take a big role again. So the nation state is, in a globalized world, is inadequate because many things are happening at a level that is not in the scope of the nation. And so it's not the right level to make decisions, and it's also sometimes too big for local decisions. But some chapters argue that it is nevertheless the frame in which the demos is really formed and operates, right? So it's hard to get rid of the state, and perhaps it should be reinvested. Another alternative is just to dilute the power of the state and have more coordination above the state and more decentralization below the state. So that's very much a debate. I don't know where it will go and whether the report will say much more about that. Do I have 1 minute or should I stop here?
Maximum.
Okay, so that means I've been too long. Okay, so there are interesting cultural shifts. Expansion of what I call the respect circle. So we have now more respect of people who are not just white men. So that extends to many other forms of people, including forms of life and natural entities. So really interesting thing. But of course, there is a backlash. And so there is a lot in the third part of the report about the issues of belonging and identity, which are a bit scary to some extent, but also potentially very interesting and very promising. So there is a proposal to reinvest the notion of belonging to make freedom and equality and such values much more interesting. I can't say more about that. There is a lot about religion, and there is interesting, so I think there are very good proposals about how to deal with religion. I'm from France, and you know in France we don't know how to deal with religion, so I think I found the solution in the report. I can tell you more if you want. The last thing I wanted to mention is that one thing that I don't see very well explained so far is who will make progress happen? What are the actors? What are the drivers of change? And so government can still play a role much more than even governments themselves think, because governments are afraid of capital flight. The capital flight doesn't occur as much as they believe. And international cooperation is hard but not impossible. there is a big question mark about social movements. We have new social movements, but what to do with them and what are the promising ones? That's okay. There are things here, but and very little about things like sharing economy, the benefit cooperation, and so on. This is something that is not developed much in the report. There might be more to say about that. Now, why do I have many slides? Because I'm preparing a bunch of slides that summarize the various chapters, go into more detail, right? So I haven't been able to finish all that so far, and I won't go through them, of course, but that's the goal. So essentially, what I'd like to be able to do is to spend 5-10 hours on the report at some point, if people want to have a sequence of lectures that go through some detail. Thank you so much for your patience.